We saw that each cross-section rotates as a rigid body as assumed in the analytical solution. So if I look at two planes next to each other, one of the planes that's twisting more is going to slip past the plane next to it. So we're just going to create a shear. So I expect the shear on these faces to be the largest, which is what you get from the analytical solution. And we expect the normal stresses to be small. So I'll focus on the shear stresses here, but you should do a due diligence and also look at the normal stresses and make sure that they are small compared to the shear stresses. So let's take a look at particular components of the shear stress. Highlight solution in the tree and say stress. Instead of, I can do normal, but I wouldn't do that. I'll go to shear. And I'll do it over the entire geometry. And now the plane I want it in is z is the, so it has to be z is the normal to this, this surface. So it has to be z and let's say x. Z has to be in there. So or xz, zx or xz. And then I will say evaluate all results. And then if I zoom out and get a view over here, I see that there is no variation along the length of the cylinder, which is what you expect from the analytical solution. Now, one thing that is a little surprising here is that there is no end effect. When I was doing this initially, I thought, okay, it'll match the analytical solution away from that end. So there's a subtlety there. I will get to that a little later. And then it's also, we can also look at the shear stress over a cross section. So for that, instead of plotting it over the entire geometry, I can plot it over the cross section. So for that, see, it doesn't let me change the selection. So I have to go and clear the generated data. And now I can say, hey, I want to plot it over a surface, and we have created only one surface here, and then evaluate all results. And then if I look along C here and zoom in, so this is sigma ZX or XZ along over that cross section. In fact, it's better to switch to a cylindrical coordinate system. And so let's do that. So let's plot this in the cylindrical coordinate system that we created. And what we want is actually YZ. Okay, so let me make an annotation here. Selected the right one this time. So with this selection, so we have shear stress in a cylindrical coordinate system, and then y should be interpreted as theta. So with those two selections, what I'm plotting now is sigma theta z, which is the same as sigma z theta. So I'll go and rename this. I'll say rename this as sigma z theta. And then if I evaluate the results, okay, and let me just minimize that, I see that, there's no variation of the of sigma z theta in the circumferential direction, and in the radial direction it increases. And that is consistent with what we expect from the hand calculation. So if I go back to the hand calculation slide, this is the magnitude of the shear, and the component sigma z theta is really the only shear stress that is non-zero or non-negligible. So sigma z theta and the shear magnitude should match. And in fact, it'd be good for you to do a hand calculation and check that if you calculate this value at the outer radius, it matches this value here, about 23 megapascals. And even better, one can extract the value along a line and then compare it and plot it, versus that and see how the two compare. So let's draw a line and extract sigma z theta along the line. So what I'll do is I will duplicate. In fact, I should have done without results. So I'll just say clear generated data. And then I'll say rename sigma z theta along line. So we have to draw the line, and for that we have to create we'll draw a line from here to here, and for that we have to create coordinate systems that have the origins there. That's the most convenient way of doing that. Or actually, I don't even need to do that. I can do it in the offset coordinate system. So in the offset coordinate system, I want to go, so let me go back to a view like that. And so I'll use this offset coordinate system. I was doing it a little bit differently when I was practicing this. And I will use the Y. So I will say create a path. And I will use my offset coordinate system, and I want to start it at the inner surface, which is y equal to 0.2. That's the inner radius, okay? And then the outer radius, so again, I'll go to the offset coordinate system, and then the outer radius is 0.35. Okay, and then if I look, so it looks like that's the right kind of line I want, and I can look along Z, and I see that, okay, it's going from the inner radius to the outer radius. And I believe getting 49 samples will give you, the spacing between those samples to be a little bit more even than what is the default. Okay, so let's. With that, and in fact, I can rename this. I'll rename this line in the middle. You can probably come up with a better name. So I'll go here, and then I'll say, okay, now plot it on a path over my line in the middle. And then I will say, evaluate all results. Okay. So I have, it shows me that variation along that line, and if I go to graph now, it sees that, oh, I have a linear variation which is consistent with this hand calculation or with the analytical solution. And I can also look at the tabular data, and let me just expand that. And you can export this. This is the data of the distance along the line versus the corresponding sigma z theta. I can export this to Excel. So if I say export, and I can say Excel, and then I can, pick desktop or wherever. Or you can just select everything, Control A, copy everything, Control C, and then go to Excel. And if I create a new sheet, for instance, I can just copy and paste there. So this is my answer solution, and then I can calculate the corresponding analytical solution and make a plot and compare the two, which would be an interesting exercise. So I would recommend that. And going back to the end boundary condition, so if I look over here and let me plot this clear generated data and then plot this versus for the entire geometry. Okay, you see that it's constant along the in the along the z direction. And but if I now applied the moment in ANSYS, not in the default way, but we applied, we created four forces and so on, what will happen is the shear stress near that end would change, and will not match the analytical solution. But once you're far enough away from where you're applying that load, it will match. It should match the analytical solution. And here, we are incorporating the Sentiment principle that once we are sufficiently far from where we are applying the load, the effects of how we apply that load, that moment, are going to diminish. So the analytical solution is valid everywhere. Only you apply that moment or the corresponding shear distribution in a particular way, and it turns out ANSYS is applying that moment and distributing a shear on the end, an applied shear, which is consistent with the analytical solution, which is a complete coincidence. So that's a bit of a subtle point, and you might need to think about it a little bit before it really sinks in. And I will save the project.